So I think you need to say, how good are we? How good could we be? One thing for the people to have this, well, we have something called best practices, and I'm going to show you that. What we have done in our company, and you can do this by yourself. It'd be a tough one, but you can use this format. Feel free. You sit down and say, what are the right things to do? Not how to do them. You cannot get involved in how to do it, but say, what are the right things to do? So we have divided in 9 key processes: leadership or organization, root cause, planning and scheduling, skills development. We call it skills development. It's not just craftspeople here. It's also management, of course. Preventive maintenance, including operator basic care, stores management, technical database, engineering's interface with maintenance, because that's very important how we purchase and buy equipment for us, you know, facilities, tools, and workshops. Those are the key areas that we have in our what we call our assessment or our best practice tool. And then in planning and scheduling and preventive maintenance, you have a few details. We break in the planning and scheduling into the key process: work request, prioritization, backlog, planning, scheduling, execution, etc. And the preventive maintenance, we break into some areas. So once you have the areas, you can say, okay, what are the right things to do? So just give me some examples. So we have about 240 elements. But it may say, standard job plans are used for all repetitive and critical jobs. So if we say that we have standard job plans for at least the jobs that are critical and the jobs are repetitive, would you agree that that would be the right thing to do? Hard to argue with, right? That's the right thing to do. Now, everybody's thinking, yeah, that could be really hard to get to. I understand that, but this is the right thing to do. Whether we do that tomorrow or we may do that 10 years from now is a different thing. But that's the right thing to do long term. At some point, we want to get to at least our critical repetitive jobs. Sometimes you get the discussion that, well, maybe we should have our jobs we don't do very often. Maybe that should be our, that's, maybe we should have standard job plans for that. So maybe you want to add that and say, well, the jobs we don't do very often, we don't know how to do. And that's where we need more instruction. So some people add some of those jobs. Jobs are always planned before they're scheduled. So we need to know what the difference between planning and scheduling is, but we prepare the tools, materials, and everything. Planning, scheduling is who and when. So of course, we need to be able to plan it before we can actually schedule it. Now, most of us don't do that.
So you're saying you do need job plan for even repetitive jobs?
I think you have to make that. What we're saying is for very critical jobs and repetitive jobs, and assume it depends on your skills level. You really need it for the ones jobs, and I think you need the ones that you really don't, that are very critical, that you don't really know how to do. So things that are very easy to do, you guys know how to do them, but those are also very easy to document. So you also want to make sure you document the right ones. But I think the ones that you use quite often, at least for your critical jobs, but also things. If you have good job plans for the ones that are fairly repetitive that you need job plans for, you're not going to write things that you don't need job plans. If you're going to change a light bulb, it doesn't make any sense to write a job plan. So you have to make some discretions here. I mean, you have to think about what you're doing. But the ones that you really need the job plans for is what we're trying to say. Lubricants are stored in clean, organized storage area. Hard to argue with, right? We know that's important. Again, very easy to say, hard to do. Then you need to say, okay, how is that done? What does that mean? That means different things for different places. But how clean should lubricant be? What's the rule of thumb there? How do we find out? What is the logic? That's an interesting question, right? We're not going to go through that right now. But it depends on the equipment, right? Depends on where we put it. What's the clearance in the equipment? If we know the clearance in the equipment, that's where we start and say, that's how clean. We want it smaller than the clearance. If the clearance is 40 microns, I want it cleaner than that. I know that. If the clearance is 20 microns, I want it cleaner than that. That's why we want really clean oil in hydraulics, for example, because the clearances are so extremely small there. But anyways, so what we've done is we put together something called best practice. It's not you guys will find it in your plant. You have this somewhere in an assessment. You can use it as a guideline. But it could be just to sit down and say, okay, where are we? You know, how good are we? So you do a little gap analysis. And you don't need to do it as detailed as this. You can develop some of this stuff yourself. You guys had something you guys called best practices at some point. I don't know if you guys still use it, but you had like an audit tool. And you sit down with your group and say, okay, are we really following this? Do we agree this is the right thing to do?